Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we are joined by Surajit Mazumdar and Vikas Rawal, both economists from JNU, and we are going to discuss the Union Budget 2018 that has been presented today by Arun Jaitley, the Finance Minister. Welcome to Newsclick, both of you. So let's start with the budget first, with you first. How do you see the budget, the grand announcements that Arun Jaitley has made?
Well, actually the announcements were more grand than in the statement than in substance. I think that this budget particularly has reinforces the, or let's say establishes or proves how entrenched what we call fiscal conservatism has become in India. That this is the last budget of this government, full budget, before it goes into an election next year. The same thing happened with the UPA in the run-up to the elections in 2014. That even in a situation where you are facing an election, where normally you expect governments to become a little bit more populist and spend money, the emphasis in this budget is primarily on compressing expenditure rather than on expenditure. That priority is to reduce the fiscal deficit in the coming year to 3.2%, having failed to achieve what was the target for the current financial year. So the target is to reduce the fiscal deficit, and you are trying to reduce the fiscal deficit in a situation where you do not want to mobilize additional revenues through taxing the wealthy, the rich, the corporate sector. So essentially you have to rely on compressing expenditures, and therefore the claims that were made in the speech of the finance minister were not really matched by the expenditure commitments that were there in the budget itself.
Because let's come to you now, when we are talking about the agriculture sector, and since demonetization and GST, it has been one among the worst hit sectors. How do you see the budget in that context?
I think in the context of agriculture, this problem is the most clear, that you know there is the speech was high on rhetoric and had nothing to offer. The two major issues on which farmers have been agitating are the fact that they don't receive remunerative prices for their crops, and the whole problem of burden of debt on farmers. Now, the finance minister actually blatantly lied when he said that the prices that they have fixed for the rabi crops this year are already 1.5 times the cost of production. That's not true at all. In fact, the budgetary allocations that you see show nothing there that would actually be even remotely sufficient if government was to actually ensure that all farmers are able to sell their produce at 1.5 times the cost of production. On the question of debt waiver, again, he had nothing to offer at all. He made some announcement about increasing the provision of institutional credit for agriculture, but that really has nothing to do with the budget, because it's something that's done by the banks. He's not made any budgetary provisions for it. So you know, one is that he has not addressed the major demands that farmers have been making, and you know, there are a whole range, a number of other things that he has mentioned which are actually peripheral and have really not taken off. For example, this whole thing of e-nam that the government has been, you know, going gung-ho about is something that has really not taken off. They have been connecting mandis to e-nam platform, but there are no sales happening on e-nam. Nobody is able to access it, nobody is able to use it. Logistics have not been worked out and so on. So you know, these are not really schemes that actually benefit the farmers at all.
So also when it comes to other such things, social services, when like health, education, where does the budget take these sectors to? Because they are propagating this entire health program, which will cover apparently 10 crore families. Yeah. So what is the truth about it?
In fact, that's another one where he made this announcement, this grand announcement that they're going to provide insurance cover to 10 crore families up to 5 lakh rupees a year. Now, one is that underlying this is first a shift away from working in strengthening of the public health system. So instead of providing health services, you're moving increasingly towards provision of medical insurance and provision of medical services through private private providers. But even here, there is no financial commitment in the budget, if you see now. You know, even if you think of an annual premium of something like 15,000 rupees a family, you are going to be talking of something like 1.5 lakh crore rupees of allocation just to run a scheme of this kind. That's about three times the total health expenditure of Government of India. Now, where is this money coming from? There is no allocation at all for this massive grand announcement that he made. So, you know, it's really high on rhetoric and nothing.
Also, the education, expenditure on education has been slashed.
Expenditure on education as a percent of GDP has fallen, as has a lot of, you know, social sector spending. So, you know, I mean, there is a real problem here. You know, in a year in which people were expecting some relief, on, you know, given the widespread distress, this budget really has nothing to offer.
The government has also been talking about recapitalization of banks, while there is no discussion about NPAs, though they are saying that they tax corporates. How do you see that?
Well, you see, the question of capitalization of banks and all of that is really not a issue of the budget, except to the extent that you make some financial allocation for that purpose. But what is the fundamental problem? One problem is that you have, of course, in various ways tried to benefit certain kind of corporate interests by giving loans which were not really going to be repaid. So that's one part of the problem. The other part of the problem is that you have an economic context in which the conditions are not such as to facilitate or induce high levels of investment, and investment doesn't seem to be paying off. And to that extent, if banks are going to be lending to entities which want to invest, then if the returns don't come, they're obviously not going to be able to repay, and then the banks also run into a problem. But the issue today actually is that the demand for that credit from banks itself is very low and has been falling for a period of time, because the ones to whom banks want to lend are not at the moment wanting to borrow and invest. There are others who need credit, who for various commercial considerations banks are not interested in lending to them. So the real problem is, it's not that you can solve the problem of the banks, their NPAs, the balance sheets, and the economy will take off. The problem is that the economic conditions that exist today, in which large majority of the people are simply not in a position to generate any demand in the economy. That's the root of the problem, and this budget actually reinforces that process by emphasizing cutting expenditures rather than expanding them.
So the final comments, if what could have government done to correct the things that you're talking about, whether be it agriculture, be it health, or be it demand that you're talking about?
Well, the first thing to do is, of course, that you can enlarge the spending ability of the government by taxing those who have the means to pay taxes. In fact, that taxing is important for another reason, which is that you have had a growth process in which whose distribution of whose benefits has been extremely skewed. So partially to redress that itself, you should be taxing those who have the means to pay. The expenditure of that. Those second thing that you can do is to forget about this mindless preoccupation with achieving a fiscal deficit target, that it has to be 3.2%, 3% or whatever it is. None of those figures have any meaning. So you should abandon that. Once you have created both at the level of thought as well as the means, the ability to spend, then there are several areas in the economy, like agriculture, like the social sector, like education, like health, in which you can expand expenditure. And that expenditure serves two purposes. A, it eliminates or reduces the deficits that you have in your economy. That there are certain gaps, deficits that you have, which you are filling. You don't have enough education services, enough health services, enough investment in agriculture. So you fill those deficits with that expenditure. The effects of that expenditure then generate demand on the basis of which other sectors of the economy, particularly the industrial sector, where you have capacity to produce but not enough demand to make use of it, can also then grow and expand. So, it is these imbalances in the economy, in the distribution of income, in the way different sectors of the economy are linked to each other. Those imbalances, if they have to be addressed, fiscal policy of the government, where you tax from and where you spend, becomes a very important instrument. And the emphasis on simply keeping the taxes low, keeping the deficit low, has meant that governments have become incapable of using this instrument.
Your final comments, Vikas, on the same thing?
Well, I think this was a moment in which the government should have sought to increase spending on, as Surajit was saying, on a whole range of services, on a whole range of basic sectors, agriculture, employment. In NREGA, for example, has seen no rise of spending, when in fact you have a huge problem of arrears of payment for NREGA. Now, those are the things in which government should have sought to, should have tried to expand its spending, and should have used this moment to also raise taxes on the rich, increasing income tax collections, direct taxes, and that was the way to go.
Thank you, both of you. Thank you for watching Newsclick. We'll be following budget in coming days also. Thanks a lot. Keep following our website and see our Facebook page.